To the splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, and all the earth rejoices, all the earth rejoices.
I was blind, but now I see. You broke the chains that had a hold on me. I am redeemed by the blood of Jesus, my God Almighty. I will sing to the Lord for the wonders He has done, and I will shout to the world of the goodness of the great I am. Praise your name, oh God. I will let the whole world know how great is your love. You're the one who lifts us up, King of all creations, earth and the heavens above. I will sing to the Lord of the wonders He has done, and I will shout to the world of the rain I am. You have been forever faithful to a wretched man like me. In this little voice of mine, I will lift your name.
Good evening, teens. I am Maya Francisco from the ICOC Makati Region Teens Ministry. And here with me is my wonderful wife, Lucy, and my son, who recently got baptized, Justin. We welcome you to the first ever ICOC Philippines Teens Ministry Virtual Conference. Closer!
What a wonderful opportunity it is for all of us to come together to share in fellowship and in praise. My fellow teens, let me encourage all of you tonight with a scripture. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, it says, "Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, and in purity." Let us all be an example to others in how we live our lives in following Jesus.
We're all about relationships. We hope to cultivate and grow meaningful and positive relationships between another, but also go further by getting and growing in relationship with God. Be closer to each other and be closer to God. It is going to be such a great conference. we will be hearing heart-moving lessons from our awesome brothers and sisters. Closer to God, closer to one another, from Nick Galang. Closer to your family, from our elder and elder's wife, Bobby and Susan Monte Alegre, together with Nick and Shelly Galang. Emotional and mental health for teens, from Gladys Ramos.
Spiritual maturity, from Lauren Lee and art teacher, Roland Monte. Character and personality, from Mitch Guse.
Physical health, from TJ Ravena. For our purity class, from Mike Corpus and Kay Habel. Lastly, closer to God's dream and vision from Charles Paburada.
Quick shout out to all of our team leaders for making this event happen, because without you, it would. We praise God for all of you.
Let us ask God to bless our time together. Let's pray. Lord, you are our rock and redeemer. Thank you that you are perfectly faithful. You never forget, never fail, never take back a promise. You promise that when your people gather in your name, your presence is here with us. Fix our eyes on you, and let our ears be attentive to your voice. Restore to us the joy of our salvation as we worship you tonight, tomorrow, and the following days. May we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To you be the glory, both now and to the day of eternity, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hope. the world needs hope. The world needs hope. The world needs hope. Span the distance, shine your light. Healing the hurting as we go, we will bring hope, changing lives. Telling the hearts feeling sorrow, that tomorrow it'll be alright. Hand joining hand all together, we're helping to bring hope online. Do what you can, make a difference. Span the distance, shine your light. Healing the hurting. That tomorrow it'll be alright. Hand joining hand, all together, we're helping to bring hope online. Shine your light, oh, shine your light, oh. 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 Shine your light.
Yo, what's good, teens? I am so excited to be here at the Closer Conference. I mean, this is incredible. An all-digital conference, let alone all of the teens in the Philippines. I mean, this is such an incredible event. My name is Nick, and me and my wife have the privilege of serving the Youth and Family Ministry out here on the beautiful islands of Hawaii. She'll be with us tomorrow for the second day of the conference. I will tell you a little bit about myself. I was born in the Philippines, right there in Quezon City. My parents were part of the original mission team to help plant the church in Manila. And so I was born on the mission field there. When I was young, I moved to Thailand. And then soon after, I moved to the United States, where I spent the majority of my life growing up. I was baptized as a sophomore in high school. I was 15 years old back then. 15. Man, how time flies. I went to college in California. I met my wife. Actually, we started dating at the end of my senior year in high school. And I graduated from a school in California and then moved with my family over to Hawaii. My wife, Shelly, we got married in Hawaii. I mean, that's like the best place ever to get married in. And we've just been having a blast with the Youth and Family Ministry and the Teen Ministry. And I want to show you a picture of our most recent family member. You ready for this? His name is Winslow. I'm going to show it to you right now. Boom. He's a cute little bunny rabbit. And as you can see, Shelly loves the bunny. And even in the photo, Shelly, she looks very happy. But does the bunny look happy? I don't know if he looks that happy. He's like, bro, get me out of here. He's crazy. He doesn't really like to be held that much, but it's okay. We love him anyways. But it's an absolute honor and a privilege to speak to you. I visited the Philippines a couple of times since I've moved away, and every time I come back, it's home. I love seeing the disciples' faces. I wish we could be together in person, but it is what it is, and I'm grateful that God has allowed us to connect like this right now. You know, there have been many moving parts to this conference, and I do want to just have us take a minute to acknowledge, just for a second, all of the hands and the hearts that have put this whole thing together. I mean, I don't know many churches in the world who can pull off some of the amazing events that the Philippines does. I mean, let's just get real for a second. And they've worked really hard to put this together, and we should acknowledge them. So thank you guys so much for making all of this happen. And on that note, I mean, if I could just speak to you for a second, I want to tell you that you are so blessed. If you're watching this right now, we are so blessed, and we are so privileged to have what we have. God has looked after us. I mean, 2020, right? It's been a crazy year, but God has absolutely looked after us. He's taking care of us. And I really believe that this weekend is an incredible opportunity to draw closer to Him. And that's exactly what we're talking about tonight and the whole weekend. It's being closer to God, being closer to one another, being closer with our family members. You know, it's interesting that the title of this whole conference is Closer, because in a lot of ways it's like kind of the opposite to what 2020 has been like, right? I mean, for all of us, we've been instructed to stay away, to isolate and quarantine. And the theme scripture is John chapter 15, verses 1 to 17, all about how we are to remain in the vine, to remain in Jesus. He is the one that we are ultimately trying to get closer to have a close relationship with. We want to keep His commands and be closer to Him than ever before. I hope that you take advantage of this weekend, guys. It's a good thing. It is a good thing when we can be close. It is a good thing to be close to someone. I mean, I miss seeing people all the time. I don't know how it is totally in the Philippines, but I mean, here in Hawaii, it's pretty much locked down. I mean, we're not that, it's not easy to see people, and we're not really allowed to meet in big groups. We do church online still. Everything is all digital. There's something about giving hugs. I mean, we're Filipino, right? I mean, we love hugs. I mean, physical touch is definitely one of my love languages. I just kind of miss that. I don't know if you do too. But on that note, I mean, I want to start by talking about something very important to us, and it's the largest organ in our body. Does anyone know it? The largest organ in our body is, in fact, our skin. It's our skin. The average adult skin covers about 21 square feet of your body. It weighs about 9 pounds and contains more than 11 miles of blood vessels. Your skin is what holds your body together, and it protects us from dangerous bacteria and viruses. And in hot weather, I know it's hot in the Philippines and humid, same out here in Hawaii, your skin will release as much as 3 gallons of sweat a day. Your skin even identifies you from everyone else, right? Via your fingerprint, your thumbprint. Each fingerprint is unique to each person. All in all, our skin is a very special creation by God. And one of the primary functions of skin is to help us feel the world around us. It's the primary way that we connect to things around us. There are at least 5 different types of receptors in the skin that help us respond to pain and touch. The ability to touch and feel the world around us is critical to us as humans. It can make all the difference in one's life, and that truth makes the story that we're going to read tonight all the more powerful, because we're talking about being closer, being in proximity with somebody, with something. But what if I told you there was a person in the Bible who physically wasn't allowed to do that? Even if he wanted to, he couldn't. He was quarantined 24/7, rejected by society and isolated from his loved ones. So what does it take to get closer? Tonight, we're going to look at a man who dared to come close to the living God. Please turn over in your Bibles to Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1, in verse 40, the Bible simply reads, "A man with leprosy came and knelt in front of Jesus, begging to be healed. 'If you are willing, you can heal me and make me clean,' he said. Moved with compassion, Jesus reached out and touched him. 'I am willing,' he said. 'Be healed.' Instantly, the leprosy disappeared and the man was healed." This is one of the first recordings of a healing that Jesus ever performs. And who does he heal? A leper. This is interesting because, as some of you know, I mean, lepers were considered untouchable in Jesus' society. And frankly, they're still viewed as that way in today's society. I want to show you and tell you a little bit about leprosy. Leprosy is a terrible disease. If left untreated, those who have leprosy can expect to live an average of 10 years. It usually starts with a feeling of fatigue and pain in the joints. Scaly spots start to develop on the skin and the body becomes covered with lumps and filled with pus. The face actually changes its shape so much that the sufferer actually resembles more of a lion than a human. And I'll show you a picture of that. Growths develop on the vocal cords so that the leper's voice becomes raspy. The body begins to decompose and the leper develops a terrible stench. As you can imagine, no one wanted to be around or anywhere near these people. But what may be even worse than the isolation from being touched, leprosy deprives the victim of being able to feel what they touch. The disease attacks the nervous system, compromising the body's ability to feel pain. The leper might step on a sharp object or a hot surface and injure the foot or the hand, but be totally unaware that there's a problem. Infection sets in and eventually the injured foot or hand might actually just fall off without them even knowing it. So for the safety of everyone, God imposed a quarantine. Yeah, God was the original inventor of the quarantine. He imposed a quarantine in the Old Testament on those who suffered from this disease. They were called unclean. And in Leviticus, leprosy is the most serious form of uncleanness. Because you see, all the other forms of uncleanness require that a person stay away from the temple for a certain period of time or to live outside for a certain period of time. But leprosy required the person to live outside the entire camp of the Israelites, to be utterly cut off from the congregation of Israel. I mean, this sounds a lot like what we're going through right now, doesn't it? I mean, 2020, COVID. Sounds a lot like what a lot of people must be feeling during this season. Isolated, quarantined, alone. I don't know if you're with me on this or if you can relate. But the lepers were kicked out of society. They were forbidden to enter the temple, forbidden to have contact with friends, forbidden to have contact with their families. And in Leviticus chapter 13, verse 45, the Bible reads that anyone with such a defiling disease must wear torn clothes. Let their hair be unkempt, cover the lower part of their face like a mask, right? And cry out, unclean, unclean. As long as they have the disease, they remain unclean. They must live alone. They must live outside the camp. The leper was always dressed in raggedy clothes and he had to constantly cry out, unclean, unclean, so that everyone around him would know not to get anywhere near him. And we don't know anything about this man. Mark chapter 1 doesn't say anything about him. None of the other Gospels, the parallel stories of this, mention anything about the man except for his condition. We don't know his eye color. We don't know his hair color. We don't even have a name. It's one of Jesus' first miracles, but he doesn't even have a name. We don't know his name, but we know his issue. Sometimes your identity can be consumed by your issues, right? You can become more known by what's wrong with you than who you have the potential to become. To the point where your issues can become your very identity. And this is exactly what had happened to this man. He had been labeled an outcast. This was his identity. Because of his issue, this was the conclusion he and everyone else came to about himself. He was a nobody. He was discardable. He was a leper. So I've got to ask tonight, what's your issue? What is the condition that you are battling with that separates you from God, that isolates you from others? Do your issues consume you? Do they define you? Has this season of COVID not only separated you physically, but spiritually? How has your closeness with God and others been this past year? Because you see, the greatest pain of leprosy is not physical. It is emotional. It is the pain of isolation. So now we can understand the significance of the first part of this message. A man with leprosy who had no name came to him who is the name above all names. I want to let you know, guys, right now, that whatever name your issue has, there is a name that is above that name, okay? And if there's any message I want to get through your computer speakers or your headphones or your TV or whatever you're watching this through, is that there's a name that knows our issues. There is a name that is above our issues and the solution to our issues. And his name is Jesus. It is the name that we glorify. It's the name that we serve and the name that we are trying to draw near to. And it's at that name of Jesus that every tongue will confess that he is Lord of heaven and earth, and every knee will bow. And it's this same Jesus who the leper, with all of his issues, decided to come to. And in the religious sense, I mean, he did it all wrong, didn't he? I mean, he did it all wrong. He broke every religious rule that there was in the book. I mean, he didn't, first of all, announce himself unclean, unclean. He didn't do that. He didn't identify himself by his issue, unclean, unclean. And he didn't keep an appropriate distance from Jesus at all. Because as we know, as a leper, you were supposed to stay away. And by away, I mean like far away. And this law wasn't meant to be like cruel. It's just that leprosy was so contagious that you could get it just by being in the same area as someone who had it. So everyone knows, kind of, you guys all know the universal piece of advice given to us right now for when we're like out in public or with others. It's to socially distance, right? It's to socially distance. For us here in the States, it's 6 feet, which I believe is like about 2 meters or so, maybe. For you guys, you may know it that way, but we're all familiar with it. But for a leper, the law for them, what was required of them, they needed to stay 50 paces away from people. So instead of 6 feet, try 200 feet. 200 feet. Just imagine this kind of isolation. A person might not have known a particular individual was a hated tax collector in a crowd if they were walking through it. They may not have been able to know when they passed a prostitute, but the person who had leprosy could never hide who he was. He wasn't granted that privilege. He couldn't hide his sickness from the crowds. But you know, maybe the leper has had an advantage over all of us. You see, his issue was on the outside. A lot of us don't have spots on our skin. We have secret spots. Issues that you can't see. You can be in a crowd and no one would know what you're carrying around. And even now, people think that the issue is COVID, but let me be frank with you. The issue has always been sin. The issue has always been the things that we carry inside that we keep there in the darkness. And this conference, guys, this conference may be the best opportunity you will have all year to be closer to God and closer to one another. But you need to decide to bring your issues into the light. You have a whole ministry around you, hundreds and hundreds of other teens who have issues. People who can help. A loving God who can heal and to help. But you need to make a decision to not let your condition remain in the darkness. This whole conference revolves around having greater spiritual intimacy, and intimacy requires proximity. And so this leper heard that there was a man who had been standing up in synagogues and telling demons to sit down and shut up, and he figured if Jesus can deal with demons, maybe he's got something for my skin too. And you've got to be encouraged by this. I mean, if Jesus can do it for someone else, man, he can heal you too. He can help you out too. You just got to go to him. So what did this leper do? He made the decision to move. He decided that it was time. And so he took that walk, 50 paces. He took that walk of shame. I want you to do an exercise with me right now. And I want you to close your eyes. Okay? Just close your eyes. And imagine this for a moment. Your eyes closed? I'm going to take us through these 50 steps that this man had to take to get to Jesus. Okay? You ready? The first step must have been the hardest. Man, if I stay here, I'm going to die. But I'd rather die trying to be whole than to live half-hearted like I am right now. 50, 49, 48, 47. Because the danger of isolation is much greater than the risk of intimacy. I'll say that again. The danger of isolation is much greater than the risk of intimacy. That's literally the whole message if you want it in a sentence. 46. 45. All right. I'm looking around. No one stopped me yet. 44, 43, 42, 41. I've still got a long way to go. But I'd rather find out for myself. 40, 39, 38, 37. I'm not totally sure about this, but I've got to try. Because if all of this is true, if He is who He says He is, then I can hold my daughter again. Then I can see my family again. 36, 35, 34, 33, 32. I don't even know if I'm going to make it to Him because they can kill me for what I'm doing right now. They can kill me for coming too close to people. They can stone me outside of camp. But I see the crowds in front of me now. I have to get to Him. I'm getting there. 32, 31, 30, 29, 28, 27, 26, 25. Are I still close? Can I be honest? Pursuing God, taking steps to Jesus is not easy. Imagine this man's anguish and insecurity and fear breaking all these rules right now, doing something that he wasn't supposed to do. It's having a relationship with God and getting closer to God. I'm not saying that it's easy, guys. It takes guts. It takes determination. Can you imagine the eyes? If your eyes are still closed, imagine the eyes of people watching you as you're doing something you're not supposed to be doing that is so countercultural to what people would think of you to do. The crowd will tell you to quit. The world will tell you lie after lie. Satan will try to do his best to get you to turn around, but you've come too far and you can't anymore. 24, 23, 22, 21, 20. There's a point that comes in your life. You don't even care anymore about what it looks like or what it's going to cost you because you're just desperate to be healed. 19, 18, 17, 16. You need some determination in your life, guys. You want to get closer to God and closer to one another? You've got to know that you need it. You got to know that you need it just like this man. 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10. Man, all these people are watching him now. He's got all eyes on him, man. You know that Jesus was never without a crowd, and so you know that there were some people staring. And our relationship with Him is not going to come overnight. Our relationship with God isn't just going to happen by attending some online conference. It's not going to happen by logging into Zoom once or twice a week with your teen ministry or watching Sunday service from your home. It's going to take real action. It's going to take real determination on your part. I don't even know where I am anymore in counting. Let's start from 10. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4. Am I really going to do this, man? Am I really about to do this? I got to find out for myself. 3, 2, 1. Here I am, Lord. I'm a man of unclean lips and I have a lot of issues. And you can see by my skin that I'm defiled, but I'm here. I'm not supposed to be here and I know that they could kill me for being here, but I'm still here, man. I took 50 steps to get to you that I wasn't supposed to take. You can go ahead and open your eyes if you haven't yet already. But Scripture says that as He came up to Jesus, He took a posture. He took the posture that we are all supposed to take when we come into contact with a king, with the Lord. And it's that He fell on his knees.
He did this.
And he must have felt so embarrassed, but also incredibly determined. He said, I don't want to be my issues anymore. I'm here, Lord, and I'm humble. I'm begging you because I have no other options. I'm begging you because I know that you can heal. I've heard about you. I'm out of place, but I'm here. You know, teens, I think one of the things that is so important that we have to understand is if we're going to get closer to Jesus, we need to take a similar posture as this leper. It requires humility out of you, true humility. One where you understand and you know and you feel that there is no other option. That I'm sick. That I need help. That I need healing. I wonder where our hearts are at tonight. I wonder if they're hard or soft. But I want to implore you and encourage you guys to have true humility like this leper and take the same stance that he did. It's a humility that comes before Jesus and says, I'm out of place. And to be honest, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm willing to listen to you. I want to know you. I want to hear you. It's a humility that will get you to fall on your knees. I want to encourage you to do this next time you have an opportunity, next time you meet with your ministry or with one another, whether it's over Zoom or in person. I want to encourage you to pray on your knees together. Because if you have determination and if you have a humble heart, you might just connect with God in ways that you just haven't before. Closer. Closer. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6 says, humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that He may lift you up in due time. If we can come before God on our knees, humble in heart, God will lift you back up. He came on His knees and said, if you are willing, you can heal me and make me clean. He said, and if you will, you can make me clean. He said, I know you can. I'm just not sure if you will. He knew he didn't have any sort of claim on the God of the universe. He had no claim on Jesus. Lord, this is what I want, but I submit it to you. I place my life in your hands. I'm begging you. You know, another thing that we need, that you need, if you're going to get closer to God, if you want a true connection with the Lord, you're going to need a heart of total surrender. 100% surrender. If you want to connect with Jesus, then you've got to have a heart that is ready to just relinquish control. You like control in your life? Well, 2020 will help you to take out that control that you so want so badly. I mean, isn't it time to give it up to God anyways? I mean, it's like, God, I have no idea where you want to take me, but I'm all in. I'm not sure where I'm going, so please take me by the hand and lead me. Lord, remove my doubts and my fears and instead fill me with trust and faith. You know, there's a great quote by a man named Glenn Packiam that says, I am not in control, but I am deeply loved by the one who is. This man stepped out on faith. He wanted to feel again. He wanted to feel again. Some of us can identify with this man. You say, I just want to feel again. I want to stop living my life numb, with no purpose, isolated in my heart, thinking no one can relate. I want to feel again. I want to be close to my family again. I want to let go of the emotional scars that I have. I'm sick of the state that I'm in. I want to feel again. I want to restore my relationship with you. I want to know what love actually feels like. I want to be close to Jesus. I just want to feel. God, help me to feel again. And Jesus, in His great love and mercy, heard this man's cry, and the Bible says that Jesus was filled with compassion. You know, in other translations, and if you have an NIV version, the Bible says that Jesus was indignant. Go ahead, look at your Bible if you haven't looked at it this whole time. I'm playing. If you know what indignant means, then you know that it means like angry, like upset, like undignified. So which is it? Was Jesus filled with compassion or was he indignant? Yeah. I mean, the Greek word here is splagnitsomai. Yeah? Repeat that after me. Splagnitsomai. It means from the gut. The English is kind of weak here, the translation, but it means this overwhelming emotion that comes from the depths of someone's soul, from the gut. Jesus was filled with overwhelming emotion, both in compassion for the leper and anger that he had to suffer like he did. And Jesus felt his pain. He felt the agony of his isolation, his physical isolation and his spiritual isolation. He felt his anguish and it welled up inside of him. I mean, this is our God. I mean, this is the Lord of Lords. I mean, what kind of God feels this deeply about someone like this? We're talking about the God of the universe here, feeling an overwhelming sense of compassion for someone as cast out and as insignificant as this leper. And herein lies the climax of this whole story. Jesus does something so risky, so abnormal, so unacceptable, and so countercultural. I mean, Jesus breaking every rule that there was, he reached out and touched the man. The real story here is not that Jesus just healed the leper. The real story here is that Jesus actually reached out and touched him. Think about it. I mean, touching someone with leprosy was pretty much a guaranteed way of getting infected. And if you look at Jesus' other miracles, you can study them in the Gospels. Jesus didn't need to touch anyone to heal them. There are plenty of instances in the Gospel where Jesus just simply spoke, snapped his fingers or whatever, and people were healed. And even in Luke 17, there's other instances of 10 lepers that Jesus heals, and he speaks it, and all of them are healed. He didn't put out his hands or touch a single one of them. He just tells them to go see the priest, and on their way, they're healed. I mean, it just begs the question for me, like, why would Jesus need to step out and do something as bold as touching a leper? But here was a man who for years had never known the sympathy or affection of another human being, who had lost the capability to feel entirely. He was numb on the outside and the inside. Someone who hadn't felt the warmth of a family's hand for years. Family member's hand. It was a 24/7 quarantine for him. Because a leper didn't say, "Heal my disease," right? He said, "If you will, you can make me clean." And while those two may seem like one and the same, there's a subtle difference, but significant difference between the two of them. You see, the leper's disease is what caused him a great deal of stress, but it was his uncleanness that separated him from his God. There was something this man needed that the others didn't. This man needed more than just healing. He needed personal attention. He needed the personal attention only the love of God could provide for him. He needed to feel the warmth of the hand of God. And isn't that just true for you and me? I mean, we don't just need to get our issues fixed. We need to be made clean. And I love this because we may not know what we need, but Jesus does. We may not know, but if we come to Him, He will take care of us in the ways that we need. Jesus knew exactly what this man needed. This was a touch of compassion. It was a touch of connection. It was Jesus linking Himself directly to the healing. He reached out and He touched the man. Because when other people looked at Him, they saw a leper. But when Jesus looked at Him, He saw His Son. And when He looks at you and me, He sees His Son, He sees His daughter, and He wants to be close. That's all that a parent wants for their child, is to be close. And he says, come to me, come on. I am the vine, right? Jesus is not ashamed to identify himself with me. He's not scared to reach out and heal me. He's not worried about catching what I got. He's not concerned about what others have labeled you or what labels you even give yourself. He doesn't care what you've done. He doesn't care what you look like. Jesus reaches out for us in spite of our flaws. And I've heard, I am the bread of life. I've heard, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I've heard, I am the gate. I've heard, I am the good shepherd. I've heard, I am the resurrection. But how about this one? I am willing. I am willing. This is Jesus. And his desire is to be close with you. He's willing, guys. Hebrews chapter 4. Verse 15, as we close out, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in times of need. Praise God, we have a high priest like Jesus. Jesus is willing to heal. He's willing to reach out. We just have to position ourselves accordingly. Are you ready to do that, guys? And so we come to the end of this interaction between this man and Jesus. And just here's the kicker here. Let's go back to Mark chapter 1, verse 43. It says that Jesus sent him away at once with a strong warning. Hey, see to it that you don't tell this to anyone. But go, show yourself to the priests and offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as testimony to them. The English here says that Jesus sent him away with a strong warning. It's like a stern warning. And the English here, again, is kind of weak. It's not necessarily wrong. It's just weak. The Greek word here literally means to snort at. Like Jesus, it's a word that comes from what horses do when they're angry. You know, they flare their nostrils and kind of snort at you. I mean, I know we normally want like snuggly, bubbly Jesus, but we get snorting Jesus here, right? And he says, hey, don't tell anyone what I did to you, because if you tell other people, they're just going to want to get healed. And I'm not here to just fix their issues. I'm here to die for their sins. I'm here to forgive their sins. So what did this guy do? Mark 1:45 says, instead, he went out and began to talk freely, spreading the news. Rip, bro. Like, GG's, man. Like, come on, dude. He straight up disobeying the Son of God right after he heals you of an incurable disease. Like, ugh. But I could talk about that a couple different ways. But, I mean, isn't that a normal response when you've been healed and forgiven of your own sin? Isn't that a normal response for one who has put themselves out there, brought their sin to the light, and Jesus still loves them anyway? For that person, no one's going to have to tell you to share your faith. You with me? No one's going to have to tell you to read your Bible or tell you to pray or tell you to come to group or tell you to come to teen events or come to church. It's just going to flow from you. It's going to flow from your heart. And I can imagine it was similar with this man. He's like, oh my gosh, I got to find my family. I got to tell my kids. I got to find my wife. I've got to find all my friends and show them what the Lord has done for me. You need to come meet this man, guys. You need to see this guy. He's amazing. And that's the whole point of it, right? Guys, we're not just here at this conference. We're not here just to be at a conference. We're here to meet Jesus. We're not here just to tune in to some cool presentations or see familiar faces because, you know, it's cool. I mean, we're here because we're sick. And we need Jesus to heal us and to cure us and to take care of us. We're not here just to make a memory. We're here to change our eternal destiny, guys. It's all about drawing closer to God and subsequently to one another. This man went around and told everybody, even when he wasn't supposed to. And what happens here at the end? At the end here, Mark 1, it says, as a result, Jesus could no longer enter a town openly, but stayed outside in lonely places. Yet the people still came to him from everywhere. So do you see it? You see what's happening? Jesus could no longer enter a town openly, but stayed outside in lonely places. Do you see it? At the beginning of our story, the leper was confined to isolation and lonely places. But by the time everything is done and dusted, Jesus was where the leper belonged. At the end of all this, Jesus actually takes the leper's place. And herein is the gospel. This is not a complicated or fancy message. It's just the gospel. He didn't just heal the man's skin. He took his place. And that's why I praise him. Not because my family always went to church. Not because I feel guilty. Not because my friends told me. But because he took my place. Jesus took the leper's place. He took my place. He took your place. And on that cross, as Jesus died, he who knew no sin became sin for us, that we may become the righteousness of God. He himself was separated from God so that we could draw close to God. Because of his sacrifice, you and I have the opportunity to draw close to God. If that doesn't amaze you, then I don't know what will. So teens, open up your hearts this weekend. It's time for you to take steps to Jesus. It's time for you to bring your issues, your conditions into the light. It's time for you to get some grit, to get some determination. Stop listening to the world. Start going to Jesus. It's time to get on our knees and humble ourselves before him, because that's the attitude and attitude of surrender that we need to really make the connection with him. Be humble. Be surrendered. I can't wait, guys. I cannot wait to see how God moves this weekend. I'm so excited. Praise the Lord. I love you all.
Nick, thank you so much for sharing the lesson tonight. The story of the leper is something that we all can relate. You know, he's been isolated. He had many issues that affected him. But what's inspiring about the man is, like you said, he doesn't have any problems inside. You know, he had the humility, he had the courage to approach Jesus despite what people will say or think of him. That is something that we need right now. We need to approach Jesus with humility and total surrender. What a great lesson for all of us as we open up our closer conference. For our announcements, number one, for all the teens, we want to remind you, please make sure you're already registered on the AirMeet event. We send the link already through your email and through Messenger. So please click the link, register, so that tomorrow when we go live, you will just enter the event. All right? Second, for all coordinators, please make sure that you gather with your teens, you talk about the lesson, and get their responses, know their decisions, and pray for each other. Because there's so many things to learn tomorrow and even tonight. So encourage them and help them to participate before we end the night. So that's it. It's been an amazing evening. Please have a good rest. Be ready to connect and be closer to God, to your family, and to one another. So welcome to the Closer Conference. See you all tomorrow.
Kami nga pala ang Teens Ministry na MC, or also known as Mandaluyong San Juan Hijo. Oo, kami yun. Hindi mo alam. Kasi ngayon malalaman mo na. We're all 19 to teens. 9 boys and 10 girls. And 14 of us ay disciples na. Sa boys, you have Kurt, Jericho, Renjan, Carlo, Charles, JJ, CJ, at Nico. Disciples na lahat yan. Sa girls naman, you have Hershey, Jaja, Yana, Joy, Chino, Jeline, Bian, and Pao. Lima sa kanila disciples na. So some of us ay nag-serve sa ministry, meron sa ushering, sa music ministry, at meron din sa tech. Awesome nila, no? So that is all, mga kapatid. Pray for the world. Pray for the world peace. Pray for unity. And always remember that we are called for greatness. And also live life like we do not have nothing to prove. And also, remember that we are called to bring back the greatness that God has given us each and every day.
Don't have to walk People there rejoicing with one voice, they are shouting, singing, hallelujah.